Good morning. The shocking death toll from the latest bloody conflict between Israel and Hamas is rising at a disturbing rate. At least 1,200 Israelis have died, and across the border in Gaza, 1,100 Palestinians have lost their lives. Our correspondent Edward Godfrey reports from Israel.
We're at the Barzilai Hospital in Ashkelon in southern Israel, a city which has been traumatised since the beginning of this war. We were there to speak with victims of the war when the hospital itself came under attack. As we pulled up, the siren sounded and we had to run to shelter. But that was just the beginning. Once we were inside the emergency department, wave after wave of rockets were fired by Hamas. We had to rush into the hospital along with staff there and patients as well. We kept on arriving as the Iron Dome intercepted many of those rockets, and there were enormous explosions. And after the first couple of waves, it became very clear that the hospital was indeed the target. The Iron Dome did stop most of them. However, one did get through, striking the children's centre. Fortunately, no children were injured in that incident, and we spoke with the hospital boss about it.
There were not children because we stopped the activity of this center from the beginning of this campaign, but the head of the institute was there, and by luck, minute before it hit them, he ran.
Now, Gaza continues to be hit very hard. It is plunged into darkness tonight with its main power source shutting down, forcing residents there onto generators. Israel says it has hundreds of thousands of troops amassing near the border, ready for a ground operation. But there's also some attention being paid to the country's north. There were reports this evening, local time, that Hezbollah militants paraglided into Israeli territory, and there was some gunfire. The Israeli Defence Force has come out this evening and said that is not the case, but there have been skirmishes there, and it's certainly a part of the country too that the Israeli government is keeping a close eye on.
And there have been emotional scenes in Sydney with around 9,000 people coming together in support of Israel, a community that was forced to wait several days to unite, gathering amid a heavy police presence. James Youssef reports.
Worlds away from the war zone, standing with Israel. Thousands coming together in a poignant tribute to those whose lives have been torn apart.
I'm devastated, I'm furious, I'm mad, I'm angry.
We just want to show our solidarity and send our love and strength.
It's the only thing to do at the moment.
Dover Heights in Sydney's eastern suburbs turning into a sea of blue and white, surrounded by a thick blue line. Police and guards with a visible presence, ramped up to ensure those coming together to mourn could do so peacefully.
We need to stand together, to mourn together what has happened over the last week.
Also present, a long list of dignitaries, politicians from both sides coming together with the same message.
And it's certainly a time for all of us to stand up and to stand with the people who are facing their darkest hour.
Some of you are hated and targeted, sight unseen, character untested, simply and only because you are Jewish. And it is with eternal sorrow that I acknowledge that some of that hatred was seen in your own city, and I'm deeply, deeply sorry for it.
Strong applause from the crowd, followed by song, dance, and prayer.
I think it was beautiful. I think we see the difference compared to the rally in the Opera House 2 days ago, how we seek to defend and for the protection of Israel.
When we heard that the news broke out, we're planning on going back now voluntarily to join our units.
It's so emotional. You know, just, you know, even people that we haven't met, you know, that live in a land that we all just feel so closely connected to and just have so much unity and people coming together, it's hard to describe.
Emotion on clear display, providing a message of peace and comfort for those who have suffered days of grief. James Youssef, Nine News.
And high emotion on the floor of New South Wales Parliament, where the member for Bankstown, Jihad Dib, called for calm in the community.
The chants at the Opera House steps vilifying Jewish people are not acceptable and should not be tolerated in our society. But neither should this tarnish the wider Palestinian community. Society will judge the actions of those specific people. They do not represent the majority of the community. Anti-Semitism has no place here, nor does Islamophobia or any type of racial or religious. Nor does any type of racial or religious vilification.
Well, the US government is now working with Israel and Egypt to create a safe passage out of Gaza for civilians as the bombing continues, but it is a complex process. And a warning, this story contains distressing content. The details from our US correspondent, Jonathan Kearsley.
US support for Israel is unshakable. Those are the words of the American President Joe Biden, who once again spoke to Israel's Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu today. The Americans are in talks with Israel and Egypt about how to safely get civilians, people out of Gaza ahead of what is expected to be a ground invasion from Israel. The Rafah crossing is the only way from Gaza through into Egypt, and it has been coming under assault from Israeli missiles for days now. The White House says part of what it's calling a safe path for civilians out of Gaza are needlessly complicated. American supplies have also arrived in the region, as has the carrier strike group. Another aircraft carrier has confirmed to be on the way to that part of the world as well and could be deployed closer to Israel if it is needed. This afternoon, President Biden met members of the Jewish community, thanking them for their support and then detailed atrocities committed by Hamas. Details he says he has had verified.
I never really thought that I would see and have confirmed pictures of terrorists beheading children.
The sheer horrors of this war are being laid out. Among the hundreds of the people who have been killed, 22 Americans, there are 17 still missing. Some have been taken hostage by Hamas inside Gaza. The American president said today he is working on that. But if he was to outline his rescue plan for these people, then he says they wouldn't get home safe. American Secretary of State Antony Blinken is on his way to Israel. He will meet Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu and join President Biden in reaffirming the ongoing support from the United States of America for Israel and continue the condemnation of Hamas.
Not since ISIS have we seen this kind of depravity, and we will continue to stand very resolutely against it.
Israel could also receive a visit from Ukraine's President Volodymyr Zelensky, who is reportedly showing his interest as a wartime leader in going to a country that is facing a conflict of its own. For its part, the United States once again offered another wave of support to Ukraine today and insists it can provide assistance to Ukraine and to Israel at the same time, adamant both are priorities for American interests.
Journalist Chung Lei has released a message of thanks to Australia after being freed from jail in China, a move considered a significant step forward in the bilateral relationship between the Australian and Chinese governments. We'll go straight to our federal politics reporter Fiona Willen. Fee, this is an incredible story, and the foreign minister has just spoken about her release, giving us new details.
Yeah, Davina, Penny Wong says the journalist is in extraordinarily good spirits. Chung Lei has spent her first night at home in more than 3 years after being reunited with her partner and her two children in Melbourne yesterday. She's released a statement saying, "Tight hugs, teary screams, holding my kids in the spring sunshine, trees shimmy from the breeze, I can see the entirety of the sky now. Thank you, Aussies." So the former TV anchor was detained on national security charges, but her supporters always maintained her innocence, and the Australian government had been quietly pushing for her release before making the surprise announcement yesterday that it had finally happened. Now, overnight, the Chinese government claimed Chung Lei was sent back to Australia because she'd completed her jail sentence after pleading guilty. This was the Australian Foreign Minister this morning.
Her return is a result of persistent, consistent advocacy, and I wish her and her family well. She asked what she could do for us, and I said, "You can thrive."
Now, the government's focus will now sharpen on another Australian detained in China, and that is writer Yang Hengjun. He's been behind bars since 2019, accused of espionage. Here's the Home Affairs Minister.
Something else that we're considering is the efforts that we need to continue for some Australians who remain incarcerated in China, and the Australian government's working very hard on those.
Others are being illegally detained, so the Chinese Communist Party should repeat what they've been able to do with this Australian, with others.
Nevertheless, this latest development is seen as a major breakthrough in this diplomatic relationship, and it paves the way for Anthony Albanese to visit the Chinese president in Beijing this year. We are told they're now checking their diaries to find a suitable date. Davina?
Okay, Fee, thank you.